Hi everyone. Welcome to the 2019-2020 Test Stand Automation and Regulation, or TSAR, capstone handoff. We're going to mostly hand it off to you guys today, and there's no formal thing, but the idea is that you're handing this off to the next capstone team. We have your 10-minute presentation, which is a nice 10,000-foot overview of the system, but hoping you'll take a little bit of time right now to just do the 10,000-foot overview, and then maybe show us the drive, the Google Drive, and the GitHub account real quickly, and then start going into some technical detail on all the different things. Again, understanding that this is handing off to the next generation of folks, which actually may be Jennifer and David and I this summer, and you guys, if you're going to still participate, we may actually build this stuff this summer. Anyway, with that, go nuts.
All right. Well, I'm looking forward to at least trying to build some of it, but I'll start sharing. So y'all should be able to see the block diagram. So our main focus and our deliverables were the actuator controller board, the DAC front end, Marionette, the actuator controller, which is our microcontroller, and way down here, this little guy, the thrust plate. Some stuff that kind of got absorbed into our capstone was working with the BeagleBone AI, but only to a point that we could confirm that the BeagleBone was communicating with the Marionette properly and that UART could talk to the actuator controller. So that is the big overview. And the rest of this is just the logical block diagram of SAR. So control tower over here, all the safety interlocks, the minimum standoff distance or minimum safe distance, and then just everything else we need to get up to having all of our instrumentation on the test stand, which this is out of date since ELFETS did their thing and said, by the way, we need lots more sensors. And then all of our solenoids that we're using to control the propellant flow on the test stand. All right, any questions? Okay,
I
well.
think I'll just step in with a one more 10,000-foot view thing, which is note that TSAR really is two separate points that both hit the BeagleBone AI, which is there's the actuator controller and actuator board, and then the Marionette data acquisition with the DAC board. Those two things are the sort of different sections, and the thrust plate I throw in with the DAC. And it's all powered via data, sorry, power over Ethernet from the launch control, except for the big power actuators, which have their own 24-volt battery.
Yeah. Yes, thank
Okay,
you.
just wanted to say that.
The actuator board is powered from a battery, right? We don't take power over Ethernet or have Ethernet.
No, we do. So the actuator controller gets power from that interface board, which actually has both power domains running to it. It has our low risk power domain, which is the PoE power coming from the launch tower to be able to turn on just our sensing and instrumentation. And then it also has a connection for the large battery to control the solenoids. So I think we'll start with the data acquisition side and hand that off to Mike Hall, talk about the thrust plate, which is this guy over here, and then they'll do the rest of the DAC with Conrad and Ashraf and kind of flow in that sort of
Actually,
pattern.
do you mind if we do it that I don't want to necessarily direct you guys, but I'd almost rather do it the other way. Start talking about the Marionette and talk about that for a second, and then the DAC board and then thrust plate amplifier, so it makes more sense that way, because we're kind
Oh,
of going
sure.
down the step.
Yeah, we can do that as well. Sorry.
Sure.
So I'll stop sharing and turn it over to Ashraf.
Right. So for the Marionette side, we're gonna start like getting use it back to like the main thing for the data acquisition system. It's just to transfer the analog to the digital data, then send it to the Microbome AI. But we started by this, but now we have another chip, an external chip. It's still incomplete. We have a code start for that one. We're gonna use a spy bus to use that chip to send to transfer the analog to digital, then send it to the MirrorNet. Then the MirrorNet is gonna send that to the BigBoom AI through USB. I wish I can share a screen to explain it better.
You should be able to.
Just a second.
Yeah, you guys might want to use your slides for the from the overview.
Okay. 1 second.
It's okay, there's no rush. And while Ashraf's doing that, I'll just mention that Marionette Data Acquisition System is an open source project for going from high-speed USB to, I think it's 15 analog inputs and some digital to analog converters. Oh, there you go. You've got it right there.
The GitHub page is wrong about that. We do not have 15.
How many do we have?
We have 14, unfortunately. Oh, okay. Yeah.
We have 15 plus or minus 10%.
Yeah. There are also much more spy channels than it says in like the README for the hardware.
Did you guys ever update that?
Yes. Not.
Oh, okay. Did update it.
Oh, thank you.
Is there a pull request on it then?
That's great.
Okay.
Basically, I put two spies. There was just one talking about, but I put two.
Okay.
Because like there is two that been used on the pens headers.
Mm-hmm. We may have three or four.
Connor, I'm just gonna make you stop sharing so I can share. Is it okay?
Because we cannot share. Sorry, that's Jake's screen.
Oh, Jake. Yeah. Right, and this is basically. What we have hooked up to the Marionette, we have the DAC input board. This one, we could not test if it's powered up whenever I hook it to the Marionette. So we have to do some testing whenever I get the equipment or something. So I still work on it in the summer. So see like if I can get the power, see if the spy is sending the data. We have a software Python, support spy. It only in the Marionette page, as you said, he said there was only one spy, so we changed it. We make it there is actually two pins of the spies. We also have the Marionette hooked up here with the USB with the BigBoom AI. This one is just to send the data. So basically, my brain, it would be the BigBoom AI. The one that I will have all my software there because it's technically this Linux system. So the only one that can communicate with the Marionette. So he will tell the Marionette, I want to do something. Then the Marionette will give it to him. So whenever I receive the data, it will be just a raw digital data. We have to filter it a little bit. We have to get 1,000 samples per second. So we're gonna whatever I mean by filtering it, we're gonna take maybe one sample, averaging those samples. Then we're gonna make sure to send it to the actuary controller on UART. So I already enabled UART 5 and on the BigBoom AI. So we're going to use that to send the data. Also, we're going to make sure to get from the actuary controller like heartbeat signal. So we're going to make sure the actuary controller is basically still alive there and still functioning fine. Whenever the BigBoom AI receive that, confirm it. So we're good. So this is the main thing for the BigBoom AI over here. And I think that's it for the side of the Marionette. I mean, we can let Mike talk about the thrust plate site.
Okay.
Or did we want to talk about the DAC input board first?
Yeah, let's start with the DAC input board, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to steal the screen.
Since the thrust amplifier plugs into that.
Okay, so you can see Eagle here?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so this is the front-end board. This has all of the connections between our echoing sensor count and the marionette. This is the connection between the marionette and the front end. This is the 220 connectors. Over here we have the thrust plate connections. This is the signal on the thrust plate with a grounded pin so that we have the same ground levels on both.
Actually, Conrad, sorry, will you start with the schematic and then go from the schematic to the board layout? I think it's clearer when you do that.
Yes. Okay. Will this scream at me? Okay. Let me.
Also, a quick question. Ashraf mentioned an external chip for the marionette. Is that what this board is?
Yeah, so you can see, or can you see, the schematic?
No.
Not.
Yes.
Now we can.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I don't know what you guys are seeing necessarily.
Seeing that. The schematic right now, the first sheet.
Okay, cool. Okay, so we have two additional ADCs that we've added on this board so that we have additional channels available. Both of these have 8 inputs. These sample 16 bits per channel, and then it has 100K per samples per second for the sampling rate. This has to be sent out over SPI, and this is MUX, so we send out one channel at a time. This is somewhat slower compared to the onboard stuff for the marionette, because those can sample up to 1 million samples per second. Let's see. These are all unallocated. So we have an entire ADC of unallocated channels, hoping that that's enough for any like future expansion. And then we have certain sensors that have already been dedicated. Let's see. For the unallocated sensors, we have jumpers, and this allows you to configure what kind of sensor you're using. You can choose either 12 or 5 volt power. That's currently what everything on the board runs off, either 12 or 5 volts. And then we have a 3.3 volt reference for these ADCs. Over here, these jumpers select the type of sensor. So if we have a variable current sensor, we jump pins 2 and 3. And then if you have a variable current sensor, you jump 2 and 3. And then for variable current, you jump 1 and 2. And then there are resistors that allow the sensors to operate correctly. And those have to be calculated when the sensors are chosen. Any questions there? So this is the analog connection to the marionette. These are the 14 onboard analog channels. We have 2 of these channels as configurable, and then the rest of these are dedicated either to pressure sensors or the thrust plate sensors. Okay. And then we have power regulation on the board for 5 volts and 3.3 volts. And then we have 12 volts coming from PoE. Yeah. Is there any more detail that you want with regards to schematic or?
No, I think that's good.
Okay.
Those did you address that those voltages are adjustable?
These voltages?
Yes.
Yeah, so if we So these are set with a voltage divider here. So if we needed to change whatever voltage this was putting out, we can switch this voltage divider. We're putting 12 volts in, so that has to be kept in mind with whatever is trying to be spit out here. These are switching power supplies as well, so just keep in mind.
And to add a little bit more, the reason that these power supplies are variable is so that we could just use the same power supply across all our boards when we needed to drop one in, so that we could try to get that big part discount and not have to deal with each of us choosing a different component to do the exact same thing. And so here, if we need to change the voltage, all you have to do is change the divider on the output.
These are buck or buck boost?
Buck.
Okay. I'm going to switch back over to the board now. Okay. Can you see the circuit board?
Yep.
Okay. Okay. So in this section, there are the voltage regulators. This is the 3.3 volt. And then up here is the 5 volt. Here is where the PoE or power from the PoE comes in. This is using the anti-vibration lock and connectors. And then all of the sensors are using anti-vibration lock and connectors. The thrust plate uses a 5-pin, but then everything else is 2-pin. Let's see. So here we can see the jumpers for choosing power. The jumper silkscreen is next to pin 1 on all of the jumpers in order to identify pins. And in this case, it jumps from, so you connect the middle pin to pin 1 in order to connect 12 volts to this sensor channel. This resistor is either some value in order to set up the voltage divider for a variable voltage sensor, or this is bridged for variable current. And then for variable current, this resistor is set. For variable voltage, we just ignore this. Okay. These 8 channels are all configurable. The configuration works the same for all of these. Should I talk about the like TVS circuitry here? Is that? I can't hear you. Are you muted?
You are muted.
Sorry, I'm muted. yeah, whatever you think is worth explaining to the next generation kids who what might be confusing.
Okay. So we have here we have resistors, capacitors, and then Zener diodes or TVS diodes so that we don't have scary large voltages going into the marionettes or marionette. We don't want to blow out the board because it's a 4-layer board with a lot of stuff on it, and if we break it, we only have 2 of them, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd like to not short that out. There is TVS protection on the marionettes as well, but it doesn't really hurt to be safe here. Yeah, I'm not sure what else.
Okay, that's fine.
Cover. I think that covers.
Yeah,
pretty much everything. So I'll hand the floor over to Mike to talk about the thrust plate.
Okay. If you want to stop sharing your screen. There you go. Yeah. Well, I should start off by saying that everything that I am about to say has a big fat asterisk next to it. Because, I'm talking about the thrust plate amplifier, and the portion of the thrust plate that generates the signal that is being amplified is the load cell. And toward the end of our capstone, it was decided that the load cells that we had and that I've been working with were not sufficient for various reasons that we can get into later. And I have not seen the replacements. I believe what's being ordered. I have not characterized it. So everything that I've designed for has been designed hopefully with enough flexibility that you future people will be able to just, you know, pick a couple of resistors and adapt my design to it. This is what the old load cells look like. You've got these strain gauges here. Can you see my mouse?
Yep. Yes.
So these are variable resistors that vary under tension, and they're in a Wheatstone bridge configuration. So the idea is, as pressure is applied to this plate, these blocks kind of deform. You've got bending going on here, which stretches out this side. So these are actually under tension. And then the resistance of these two resistors increases while these two are kind of control resistors. So Wheatstone bridge. The voltage differential that you get across that Wheatstone bridge is on the order of, it was about 2.5 millivolts, I think, when I was standing on it. And I'm 220 pounds. So you're not going to be able to expect much. So you need a great deal of amplification. The analog input pins on the Marionette can accept signals up to 3.3 volts, but they, as I understand it, they stop being linear as you sort of push that. So I had been designing for a range of 0 to 3. And let's see. So, all right, well, why don't I go through the schematic here? All right, so start with the power supply. I've got a 2-pin connector on the board that's going to take a 12-volt supply that's coming from power over Ethernet, which is coming from the sensor front-end board. So there's going to be a 2-pin connection between those two boards that supplies power to this board. That gets stepped down from 12 to 6 volts by this switching regulator, and then stepped down again by a linear regulator to 5 volts. And that 5-volt supply is used to power the Wheatstone bridges, or to power the load cells on the thrust plate. And 5 volts is going to be adequate for the replacement cells as well. The 5 volts also gets stepped down again by another linear power supply to 3.3 volts, and that is to supply power to the amplifiers. These amplifiers are instrumentation amps. They are basically designed to amplify small signals from Wheatstone bridges. They've got two high impedance inputs, which is important. Early on in the development phase, I was trying to use normal op amp, like the classical differential amplifier topologies with just a normal op amp, which include feedback loops and shunt resistors. And I found that that topology was actually drawing current out of the Wheatstone Bridge and resulting in weird nonlinear effects that were hard to predict and varied from op-amp to op-amp. So so we ended up going with these instrumentation amplifiers. Gain is set by one external resistor, and that has been left TBD, because I don't know what the future Wheatstone or load cells are like, and what the signal is going to be. I wasn't able to pick gain. That's something that the future Capstone team is going to have to do. Sorry, I'm dealing with a new mouse. These are the connections to the thrust plate. So this is that 5 volts coming from the that 5 volt regulator. So I've got 4 connectors here, 4 pins each. This is supplying power to those Wheatstone bridges, or to the load cells. So I've got 1 connector per load cell. So we have power, we have ground, and then we've got the 2 sides of the Wheatstone bridge. There are bias resistors here that I'm going to talk about in a second. And then we've got TVS circuitry everywhere. All connections coming, so these are the differential voltage signals coming from either side of the Wheatstone bridge. So I've got TVS on those coming into the board, and then on all power going out. And then obviously those differential signals go to the amplifiers, and then the amplifier outputs, I've got more TVS. And those are going to the sensor front end board via this 5-pin connector. So I've got my 4 amplified signal data lines and then a ground connection here. And the sensor front end board doesn't do anything to the signals. It's just providing the connection to the marionette. So this is what the signal to the marionette is going to look like right here. So that's it for the schematic. Are there any questions about the schematic before I move on? Okay. So, and this is what the board looks like. So you can see I've got this is the 12 volt power supply connection right here. I've got silk screen on the top as well as on the bottom, which is why that looks like garbage. But it's just pins labeled. Here's some TVS, and then this is the 6-volt output switching power supply, which then goes to 5 volts here. This 5-volt trace gets tapped for, these are the connectors for the load cells. And then, so then 5 volts gets stepped down to 3 volts here. These traces on the underside of the board are what are powering the amplifiers. So So here are the connectors for the load cells. And as I said, each one has a 5-volt connection, ground connection, and then our 2 data, or our 2 differential signals on either side of the Wheatstone bridge. And I mentioned I've got these bias resistors. And the reasoning behind these, and I don't know if this is going to apply to the new load cells or not, the load cells that I was working with, I found did not, the no input voltage, basically if you have no force exerted on the thrust plate, the starting voltage across that Wheatstone bridge is not zero. It's also not the same between the four load cells. And on three of them, it's not a positive voltage, which is terrible. I'll let that sink in for a second. There you go. Okay. So the reason that's a problem is, so you're starting off with a negative voltage, and that negative voltage is actually going to cross zero across your ring as you apply force. So if you think about how you're going to amplify that, when the magnitude of your differential signal starts off reducing, then hits zero, and then starts increasing. I'm sure there's a way to do that that probably involves lots of weird diodes and rectification and problems. Andrew's shaking his head. So our solution to that was to bias the Wheatstone bridges. So if you picture a Wheatstone bridge, you've got, maybe I should actually draw this. Just a second.
You can use the whiteboard functionality in Zoom, or that works too.
Oh. Well. Oh. This is still up from the last time I drew it. All right, that's handy. So here's a Wheatstone bridge. We've got our two variable resistors here. And basically what I'm doing is I'm adding access to where you can stick a through-hole resistor on either side of these two upper resistors. And that'll be enough to bias it so that the entire measurement range, the entire output range, is either completely positive or completely negative. And that's a design decision that future Caption is going to have to make. I was going to bias everything so that it starts off negative, so that our amplified output for zero input starts at 3 volts. So you've got an active, what's the word I'm looking for?
So you have a no load voltage of 3 volts that's going to decrease.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So, and so you know that, everything's connected properly, basically, when you have a starting voltage that's high and predictable, as opposed to something that could be floating. That's up to a future Capstone team as far as whether they want to make them inverting like that or not. I did experiment with these no-place resistors and various values. I found that, I should say that for our load cells, the nominal resistance of all the Wheatstone bridges, or all the strain gauges, was 120 ohms. And with maximum input of something like 8 kilonewtons exerted on that plate, that resistance is going to vary by like a thousandth of an ohm. I mean, it's really small. So you can stick a 10 or 100K resistor in these bias spots, and that's enough to cause, that's enough to shift that output range meaningfully, and did not appear to have many or much of an effect on linearity. So that's going to take a lot of experimentation by the future Capstone team to figure out exactly what needs to go in there. But that's what these are for. And I left these so they're the footprint is for through-hole and vertically mounted resistors. So you can use these as test points as well. And I've got them labeled to non-inverting and to inverting. That's non-inverting input of the amplifier and inverting input of the amplifier. All right, maybe this is a good time to pause for questions if anyone has any. Okay.
That's good.
All right. I feel like I'm running out of things to talk about, actually.
I think you nailed it. I don't think there's any more.
Yeah. Future Capstone team, if you have questions, I did leave my email address on the silk screen on this.
You are a brave man, Mike. That's awesome.
I really wanted to see this through to the end. And I intend to. So,
you know, I think I'm going to make that a requirement from now on.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. So you can always get a hold of the person who designed it. That's really a great idea.
And that's my non-PDX email address, too, because I'm planning on losing that one. So
until people set up their own shadow email accounts that just forward if they want it to.
Great. All right.
Well, I guess we'll move on to Jake.
Yeah, I can go ahead with the actuator controller interface board. And then we can wrap up with Austin talking about the firmware, the actuator controller. So let me do this. All right. Everybody should be able to see the schematic. Is that correct?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
All right. So here is that same regulator as the other ones that Mike and Conrad are using for the switching power regulator. This is taking 12 volts in from PoE, and then we're having regulated 5 volts out. Here's our connectors of a PoE connector, and then we have VBAT, which is the high current battery supply on the test stand to provide power to the solenoids. The second sheet, this is the STM Nucleo Morpho connectors, they call them. It's two rows of a 2x19 pin connectors. I left these labeled as they were from the STM documentation if we didn't use them. And the ones we are using are broken out. So this right side are all the outputs to the solenoids. And the left side is all of these sensors that we still have no idea what they are. And then power, ground. Austin did test that if we put 5 volts to this pin on the connector, that it gets routed to the onboard power regulator for the Nucleo development board. And so that's how we're planning to power it, which is why we have that 5-volt regulator. Moving on, all of these are all exactly the same. These are the solenoid switches. So starting on the right, we have a screw terminal connector. That's a standard 0.1 inch pitch. I decided to go with screw terminals because they are anti-vibration. And if you're not confident enough to know what you're disconnecting and reconnecting, you shouldn't be taking a screwdriver to it. Rather than if somebody sees a connector, like, oh, I can just unplug that and I'll plug it back in later. So it's kind of like you should know what you're doing before you take a screwdriver to this board. Here we have a little flyback protection circuit. So we have a flyback diode and just a small, ish resistor so that when we turn off the MOSFET that's controlling it, that back EMF can just dissipate through this diode and the resistor and not damage anything else. And this was
That should be 28K. I think that's a mistake.
We did use this setup with these values with the Practicum project that was switching a 3-amp solenoid.
Okay.
And this was
that again. That's just a little too high to protect that MOSFET, but that's fine. Keep going.
Okay. And then moving over, we've got the P-channel MOSFET doing high side switching, and that gate is being pulled up to VBAT to ensure that any static or any noise on this line isn't able to randomly switch on solenoids. It needs a pretty strong signal to ground to actually switch on. And then we have an N-channel MOSFET coming, the signal's coming from our actuator controller board with the STM microcontroller on it. And again, this is being pulled down to ground. So it needs a pretty strong signal to be able to switch on and pull this line to ground to actually route power from VBAT through the solenoid and back to ground. And we picked this type of switching topology to avoid the failure mode of what happens if some of these lines going to the solenoid get damaged or shorted. If we did just a low side switch, that means that one of those lines is always energized. And if something shorted to ground, the solenoids could just switch on their own. Where in this instance, if those lines are damaged and the solenoid switches on, we just pull too much current to ground and hopefully we don't actually turn on a solenoid. So moving on, again, a lot of the same. These are the sensor inputs and these are the TVS protection circuits mostly. So again, it's a standard 0.1 inch pitch screw terminal connector. There's 1K resistor, a TVS diode, and a small cap to filter noise. And then there's this additional NP resistor. It's a no place. Since we don't know what type of sensors for the valve position specifically that LFETS is going to be purchasing, we don't know what those inputs are. And leaving this NP resistor, this resistor can work in conjunction with this 1K and we can create a voltage divider. And our test plan that we're submitting has the calculated output to be no more than 3 volts to follow the same standard as Mike and Conrad so that we have that headroom on the marionette where we're not getting outside of that linear sensor range. And this is that resistor that we're doing that with. And are there any questions? Okay, moving on. And here is the board layout. It's a pretty big board, but that's kind of by necessity. So we'll start down here. This is our 12 volt power input, that 0.1 inch screw terminal connector, and going to that switching power regulator. And all this is really powering is going right back to that pin on the Morpho connector to power the STM microcontroller. The STM microcontroller has the built-in ST-Link USB connection, so you can just plug it into a computer, and Austin can talk more about that. But this top side refers to that ST-Link that kind of hangs off the top like a wing being in this area to know that the orientation is correct. We're going to go, these are, again, the sensor inputs. And so we have that first resistor, got the TVS diode, the 120 picofarad cap, and then the no place resistor to ground to set up our voltage division. And then all those are being routed to the appropriate connectors. We go over here. This is the VBAT connector because it is going to be drawing a lot more current. We went to a 0.2 inch screw terminal connector. This board has this polygon pour, which is all of the, this is VBAT plus. So this is the positive terminal of the battery is this entire area of the board. And then that's going right to our MOSFET and then right to the output and right back to ground. And the entire bottom layer of the board is a ground pour and the top layer. So that we tried to keep these short, but we still needed distance for the MOSFETs to stand up and to be able to access it with a screw terminal. And also to still have the flyback diode and resistor and leave room for that. Then coming off of that, we have the rest of the circuit, the resistor, the other MOSFET, and the other resistor pulling the signal from the microcontroller to ground. And I believe that's everything. Is there any questions about the board or the layout? All right, well, then I will turn it over to Austin to talk about the STM microcontroller.
That's assuming my mouse works. I think this will do. Can you guys see a slide?
Yeah.
So basically for the actuator controller, we had initially planned to design our own board. And I had these boards kicking around. So that's actually how we selected the STM G series microcontroller, was just that we had this. And then sometime in the middle of the process of designing this, I think it might've been Andrew, had a wonderful idea that we just use this because it actually already does everything that we really need it to do. And so that's why we have an evaluation board mating with sort of our CAPE that controls all of these peripherals. So this microcontroller does way more than we need it to, which is fine. And I'm happy with that. I would much rather have it be way over the kill than just above kill. Anyhow, so Jacob already talked about the Morpho connectors. We basically will be interfacing with all of the sensors and solenoids on those, and we'll be taking power, as Jake said, from that board as well. I have tested this, it does work. The only gotcha is that the jumper, which isn't actually accurately displayed on this, because apparently this is wrong. Anyhow, there's a jumper here that's actually a 2x4 pin jumper, and there's a place to either select ST-Link or VN, and if you set the jumper to VN, then it will take power from the outside. Otherwise, you risk damaging the board, and I wouldn't recommend doing that. Anyhow, so the important things to know for you guys is that if you want to program this, the ST-Link is built in. Typically, ST-Link debuggers. Will the recording capture my video, Andrew?
Yes.
Yes?
That's very well.
Okay, so ST-Links normally look like this, and they're unwieldy and awful. So it's kind of nice that the ST-Link is actually just this part of this PCB. You just plug a mini, I think it's a micro B USB to USB in there, and then you can just plug it directly into your computer, and it interfaces with CubeMX, which I will talk about in great detail in just a moment. Anyhow, so this is the board that we're using. You want to make sure that you get the serial number correct, otherwise you'll end up with the wrong microcontroller and nothing will work, or not in an expected way. This is just very briefly a simplified state diagram. There are other things that still need to be specified from the fire team, whoever's responsible for that, like how long do we stay in these conditions and some other stuff, but this is generally how the system will be working. There's supposed to be a test state that is able to go into any one of these states, and that's for debugging only. We won't actually put that in a production build. There's a safety state that's basically where it starts. It will not move until it's armed. Once it's armed, it goes into pre-fire, and then just goes through each of the states, and we can talk about those a little bit more in detail as they come up. And then the only other thing is that every state can go to the failure state, and that's usually triggered by either some sort of state malfunction. So if you get a state and you compare it to the list of available states and they're not the same, it goes, oh crap, I don't know what I'm doing, and then it goes to failure. Also, if you're expecting if you're expecting a valve configuration, like you set the valves a certain way, and then when you read the GPIOs to find out what the valves are actually doing, and those things are different, then the system freaks out, goes into failure, and then it just hangs out in failure and sends, you know, these failure log messages to whoever's controlling it. And then that person has to say, oh, okay, it's failed. They send an acknowledge message, and then the failure state goes to safety state and everything's disarmed, everything's shut off, and the system will not continue until it's rearmed. That's a 1,000-foot view of that. The messages, we didn't get this far. There are messages right now, but they're debug messages. They work, as far as I can tell. I couldn't really test them because I don't have a logic analyzer, but I can see on my oscilloscope that every time the system changes states, the UARTs bounce happily as if they're transmitting. I don't know what they're transmitting, but they're transmitting. And from the software side, I can look at the registers, and the registers look like they're holding the information I want them to. So, you know, I'm like 91% sure that those log messages at least are working. The idea, though, was to, instead of right now, I think they're printing just strings that say, you know, log message, this is the time. What we would like to do is encode them to have a common format that we can send a much smaller message packed with a bunch of information, and then use the BeagleBone AI to sort of decode those. And then we also want to include checksums so that we can ensure that we're getting valid messages and that we can trust them, and we don't do anything from just noise, because any bit stream is a message. So we have to be careful about that. Anyhow, it's all I wanted to show you with the slides. The big thing, confusing thing, the hardest part of this whole process, I think, is probably if you haven't used Eclipse, this is an Eclipse-based IDE. This is what I've been doing all my development out of. Andrew, you can groan if you want.
No, that's okay. I'm okay with it.
All right. So the reason we picked an IDE and we didn't do Linuxy stuff and be cool like normally we are with PSAS was that we were going to do this really fast. And doing this really fast, I didn't want to go and write all the bare level drivers and everything from scratch, because that takes a really long time. So what we did is we started this IOC project, and that's actually, you guys can't see my entire screen, like my start bar and everything.
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's not going to help, is it? Well, that's great. The one time I need it to do it, it doesn't do it. So basically, you can get this STM Cube IDE, but it's also STM Cube 32 Programmer and STM Cube 32 MX. There we go. That's what I needed. Sorry. So there's three programs that you're going to want to use. The Cube Programmer is to verify, you don't actually need this. This is just makes everything a lot easier. And when you're banging your head against the wall and your thing's not even connecting, this is just a really quick way. You can just hit connect and it'll just scan your port, your COM ports, and connect to the device. If it connects, it'll bring up all the register information. It'll say it's connected. It'll tell you what's connected. And this is a really good sanity check. I highly recommend doing this before you do anything else. I would just download this program, connect to the board, and make sure you're getting everything you expect to be getting, because if you miss this step, you're going to have a lot of headaches later. Anyhow, so then you disconnect, close it. I'm not connecting now because I'm already connected through the debugger. So that's the connection thing. The way that we got the hardware abstraction layer drivers, or the HAL drivers, is from this actuator controller IOC. Actually opens up another instance of the Cube MX. This is the hardware abstraction layer code generator. So this is what we use to develop and generate all of our driver level code. So anything like the initialization of the GPIOs, the clocks, the watchdog timer, all of that happens from here. If it opens, it's taking its sweet time. And once again, this just saves a ton of time, because all of this, I've done all this driver writing and it takes forever, just forever, ever. So this is a really nice way that you can come in here and you can select whatever it is that you want to use. And it sort of generates code that says, you know, I want to configure this to be a serial wire. I want to configure these to be GPIOs. And then there's a lot of configuration. You can turn on the DMAs if you're really brave. We've got the watchdog on. You've got ADCs that you can turn on. This is, you know, timers in case you need timers. Anyways, all your communication protocols. So basically, this is just setting up a configuration file that generates all your code that's not going to work. And you're going to have to go through and debug all of it if you do this again. but I've already done a lot of that terrible stuff for you. But if things change, things will change. Things that might change, like your input clock frequency and stuff like this. So this is all configuration stuff that's available to you if that's how you prefer to use it. However, most of that awful stuff is done, and I put it all in this init.c file. And if you want to change the clock, you can just come in here and find, you know, the system clock config, and you can change those values here. It'll do some, you have to do some digging to find out where these are all defined, but with this program, it's pretty easy. So you just pull it up. That pulled up somewhere that I don't see right now. Anyhow, it's really easy once you get to use it. That's the tool. Do you guys have any questions about the tool? Okay. So the program is organized like any other C program. You start at main C. For every file that we've developed, I think I've created this header format, and this should, you know, tell you what it is, what it does, any important things for safety or just using it should be in here described. And then I've tried to write my code in a way that, you know, you can read it. So it's a state variables, controls, failure, safety, so that the code is somewhat English. But this will help for like control F debugging, trying to search for things. I try to write stuff in the header files. I'm not very good at that, admittedly, but that's the intent. The risk factor I took from NASA's software, critical software writing standards, which I linked in our report. You can find that there. It's really great read if you're really incredibly bored, but they have some very good recommendations for doing this kind of work. It is insanely dry and horrible, but it was really useful. Anyhow, so in main, we declare these control variables. These are specified in a different file that is also very important that I think I have open in my other screen. That's how important it is. I just like to look at it occasionally, but I will show you all. Oh, did I delete it? There it is. Nope. The other really important one is actually just a header file. This is the definitions of things. These are our definitions, not the like driver level definitions. So these are like our state definitions. This is that struct that we start the initialization with. This allows us to keep track of how long we've been in a state, allows us to keep track of if the system is armed, if the ignition command has been given, what the last state was, what the current state is, and an address pointer to, I'll show you that in a second. Anyhow, these are the solenoids as they were defined in the state, valstatereference.xls file that I was pulling all this information out of, which I put in the references in the header file, which I also am bad at, but I have tried to keep accurate. I don't think these are accurate, but they can be changed really easily here. And this IDE has a search and replace function where you can replace every instance of this when you replace it here. So it makes it, once again, really easy. C doesn't do bools, so I define bools. Where were we at? Main. So anyhow, main is important. Each state requires a last state and a current state when they are different, meaning the first time it has entered that state, there is that start time is set. So you know when the exact moment you entered the state. And then after that, it resets the last state to current state and just runs through. So that variable is only set once per state. And that's important that you start out this way. Otherwise you won't know when you started safety. If you care, you might not, but that's just something to consider. Anytime I've done a hacky thing to just demonstrate that this works, I've written it in the code, I think. Once again, I hope. I'm sorry if I didn't. So right now I've just said, is it armed? Yes. And that's just so that it'll start running through the states. It puts me in a state machine. Oh, the other important thing, sorry. is the address in the struct is just pointing to itself, and that just makes it really easy to pass this address around so that you can reuse it over and over and over again. And that's part of the NASA safety standards, is that you don't want to do any, you want to do as few new delete slash dynamic memory calls as you can possibly manage. And I think that this is a way to do zero, which I think is good enough. Anyhow, real quickly, we go into the state machine. State machine just takes that struct. It pulls out the current state, verifies the current state. If that fails, it creates a log message. It sends that and sends it to a failure state. Once it's been validated, it goes into the state machine and then goes and does state stuff. This is just a switch that takes you into state stuff. So just as an example, we can go through the first state is safety, always safety, and safety will not move forward. This is what most of the states look like. Need to update the header. This is probably not as verbose as it needs to be. Like I said, I'm not great, but I strive to be better. So this, basically you come in, you have a control variable that tells you whether or not this state was successful or not. If this goes through this whole thing and comes out false, that means that something bad happened in here or something unexpected happened in here, and that should create a log message and that should set the system to fail and it should stop doing what it's doing and go do something safe. Each of these states, I've tried to put a summary of what the valve configuration should look like in English so that you can read it. And then here I've done, you know, the C stuff to create a, what's that, one hot encoded message to send to this valve setter, which sets the GPIOs based on that code. Then we take the valve configuration check and we just run this method, which reads the GPIOs. We do some comparisons with that later, say, was this operation successful? Did we set the valves to the value that we expected? Yes or no. And that is if the valve configuration is the same as the valve target, which we created and sent to the valve setter. I hate software. I'm sorry.
Thank you. Thank you, Austin.
So get valve status message. It's basically just like I created a message file. You can find those messages here. They're just a really, I don't like a bunch of dirty code. So this is just, it's like get the valve state message, create a log and do all that stuff in a different file where I don't have to look at it. And I try to name it in a way so you know what's happening. Basically, you just give it this pointer to this memory that you allocated, not dynamically. And the valve, you give it the valve configuration and whether or not the system returns success. And that creates a, automatically creates a message with a timestamp, the expected valve configuration, the actual valve configuration, and whether or not it was successful. And then just sends that to the UART for broadcasting whenever it's available. Yeah, there you go. UART send message is also one of ours. So, and then to get out of these states, the thing that's probably confusing, or maybe not, it was confusing for me, is that this is going to run through this entire process over and over and over again until the state changes. And the reason behind that is that I wanted to keep a sort of running clock, and I didn't want it to have too much of an opportunity to hang anywhere if it could be helped. And then also if we wanted events based on times, like timeouts and things like that, I really wanted it to keep cycling through. So once it gets into the safety state, it doesn't like stay in a safety method. It just sets the current last state to safety. And then it goes through until these exit conditions are met. And these exit conditions for safety is it armed? And did we do everything correctly so far? And if those two conditions are met, then it says, okay, now we can go to setup ops, which is exactly like safety, except now the machine will actually start moving. And so those things like setup ops, these all have timers, you know, at some point. So safety doesn't have a timer because we don't it's not a time thing. It's a when we're ready, we arm the system. So everything else going forward has a time system, and it basically pulls the system time since boot up. And then since that's not dependable, I basically just, you know, created this time started is equal to whenever we went into the system for the first time. This sets, make sure I explained that earlier, but this makes sure that we only set the time started once. And then every time we get the current time and we compare the current time with the timeout value. And if it times out, you know, we can do something if once that's specified, like if it took too long, or if it's just a timer that allows it to move into the next stage, then we move to the next stage. Anyhow, that's like a real sort of detailed enough, I think, thing to get somebody started. The other important thing is the utilities. The utilities just have like state utilities, like to verify your state. This is the method that verifies the state. To get the state configuration, this is the GPIO reader. This basically creates, once again, it just does that one hot encoded variable, loads it with everything that says it's on, and then returns that for you. The valve state setter does the same thing in reverse. It takes what the one hot coded variable that you fed it, turns off the GPIOs and those configurations. These all work. UART send message is insanely confusing and convoluted and not done. And we need to change it to encode information instead of sending these strings. But it works really well for sending strings right now. It just needs to be specified how to do the message, which I've kind of done, but I ran out of time. And then the receive message is not done. But the interrupt, I believe, that handles the receive message is done. So this section might need to be deleted now. I didn't even think about that until just a second. Sorry. Let me think if there's anything else. I don't think there's anything else that's important or a gotcha. It's going to be really hard, I think, to get into this, but once you get into it, I think it'll make a lot of sense. I did my best to make it make sense. Is there any questions so far? Okay.
No, I think you're right. I think that the poor kids who take this on next just need to walk through it. And once they understand it, it's pretty straightforward, which is good.
Yeah. And I, if you would like, I can hand this off to me for the summer, because it's not to the point where I'd like it to be, which is finished.
Well, we'll talk about that offline.
Sure. And then, so the only other thing is it works. The process of making it work, though, is if you have the system, once everything's set up, sorry, I can show you. I'm literally just plugged in to a USB to the board itself. And then that's just for LEDs so you can see that it works. That is literally the only connection you need, so long as that jumper is in the configuration I mentioned earlier where it's on ST-Link. So from the build, you can just clean from a clean build. You'll just have this project. It's really easy, just build project. And then debug from this screen once it's built. We'll automatically load it into the microcontroller. I'm gonna laugh if there's any errors. yay, warnings, that's fine. So then once you hit debug, it just automatically loads through the connector, gets you to an entry point. You can start it. And we'll just hit start, and I'll show you the video of that. I can't see myself, so I can't tell if you guys can see this.
Nope, point a little bit more towards the thing.
There we go.
Yeah.
So we hit start, and like I said, it's already armed. It shouldn't be, but there you go. It's switching through. And if you guys want, we can sit here and watch it for a minute and it'll get to the end and then stop because I have it disarming in the post-fire stage and then it just sits there forever. That's boring, so we're not going to do that. But if you hit the reset button, you can tell now it's just booting up from the power. Oh, yeah. No, that's right. Is it? That's hard to tell because it's reversed in my screen. Anyhow.
Good.
I do have one quick question I didn't think of until just now.
Yeah.
Can the dev board be powered from 5 volts from the actuator controller board, but still be connected through the ST-Link?
No.
Okay, so it's powered by, so if we're powering it over ST-Link, it has to be not powered through the actuator controller board.
So to be very clear, when you plug it into the ST-Link and when the ST-Link jumper is set, that is just for debugging and loading the software. Once you've loaded the software and you change the debugger to VN and you provide it 5 volts, it will just boot up and do its thing automatically.
Okay.
So
once it's like in the live position, we're doing integration testing, we're not able to power it on from like the test stand power supply and have the ST-Link connected to have live debugging.
No.
Okay.
No, we don't have that ability. We do have the ability, once it's tested and working, to communicate with it through the UART. And if we needed some debug functionality, we could, you know, at least set up messages that we can send back and forth that
and,
way.
And Austin is lying a little bit, which is with an X-Acto blade, we can absolutely do that.
Yeah,
so
fair
we'll
enough.
Probably end up doing that live because we'll want to be watching and debugging while we actually do integration.
Right. Yeah. Sorry. That is accurate. Without modifying it, I don't know of a way to do what you just described. But we are engineers and we can modify whatever we want. So that's what I got. Is there any other questions?
No, thank you.
Cheers.
Can I go like a little bit, and I was going to show something for the code side of the Marinette. I kind of skipped it. I just talked about the Marinette like really quick.
Yes, please.
It's just a 1 or 2 minute.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to, do you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
So basically we're going to find the code, like let's say the good one for the Marinette code we have here. So in the Marinette code, in our TSR software, so basically everything's been updated and everything tested that working here. So we have like also the examples ones. We already got those ones from the Marinette like website here, but this one is not being updated. So we have it in here. We have like link to the software. Do not use those. Those have been like 4 years ago. It's been like on the old firmware. So those ones is not being updated. I updated everything and we have it into the right here. So we have those exact examples, but it's been updated and tested. And if you want to get started with the Marinette, you can right away have the Marinette terminal and you can have the Marinette library. So those two, those that like, if you don't know anything, you just have like Linux machine and hook your Marinette with a USB if you want to start using it. Put those two into folder, make sure have them in the same folder. And you can right away start like testing the Marinette and talking to it if you have those two, basically. Just this note I wanted to mention about the Marinette. And also if you wanna know about like the code, what it's doing, like some of the codes, I have a, in the driver, oops, I cannot pull it out. It's in our driver and the TSR driver. I kind of like doing like not engineering talk here. I was talking like literally talking everything I was doing step by step, writing it like lab report or something. So I was explaining like, okay, this doing this, how we connected this by that and even the internet. So I have like 19 pages. I was just kind of going through whatever I was doing. Yeah, it's not really formal. Oh, it's actually not formal at all, but it's kind of like explaining every step in this document. And I think that's it.
Good, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, do you guys mind going over the both the Google Drive and the GitHub.
Sure. So I've got the Google Drive up here. All right. So
first show us where this is.
We'll go back up a couple levels. So from the PSAS shared drive, we go to LFETS. From LFETS, we're going to 2019, we're going to STAR.
Yeah.
And from STAR, the capstone. And this is where we're at in here.
Great.
We got a bunch of random documents and presentation stuff we had to do. And then we've got BeagleBone AI folder, a bunch of benchmarks from Dimitri. I don't think we ended up using that very much. Not quite sure why that's in there now, but we've got the Marionette, and the sensor info is the main important things. Again, here's just kind of a repository outside of the GitHub for the Marionette info and the sensors. So a little bit of the data sheets that we have information. We got some of the pictures of actually, I believe this is, those were, all right, not what I was thinking. I think Gabe has the video of when we tested the cryo sensor. And then similar with the, pressure sensors that we did test with the hand pump. We have different output files from the Marionette of us just trying to pressure it by hand and tested them at varying voltages. And that 12 volt is where we got like the most consistent response. And that's just like the raw data for the pressure sensors. And then the thrust plate, this is Mike's design notes. And some of the basic starting point for putting that together.
A lot of that stuff is going to be obsolete as it's based on the old load cells, but I'll get it cleaned up.
Yep. So that is the share drive and then the GitHub. This is the hardware side. We've got our licenses. This is the basic README of what it is, but then we're going to be adding our other READMEs to their files. We have the Eagle libraries that we used. Most of the custom parts got added to the SAR controller library. And we all reference stuff from that. And then we have it broken up into the thrust plate, the actuator controller, and the front end board. Our BOMs are in each of the sections, and then boards and the schematics, and that is the same for all of these. And I'm not too familiar with the software side. That is a slightly different repo, so I'll let Austin kind of take over and point to the software SAR GitHub. And if you're talking, Austin, you're muted.
Man. Well, that's fun. So where were you guys at? You were in hardware?
Yeah.
Let me go. So our software, start at the top. So our software, you can drill into this. This is left over from before. I didn't touch any of this. I didn't know if we needed to. But we organized our stuff. Basically, here is the things that we contributed to this repo, is the Marionette code, the actuator controller. And I think this is still here just for Progeny's sake, but this, we reorganized all of this and left in here what we didn't know what to do with. And the actuator controller, I've got everything set up as a README. I've got some the stuff I explained earlier. This is literally the working project folder. So if you pull this repo, and you can build from this if you set your workspace and download all of this stuff in there. There are some things that are not code that are in here, but the compiler will ignore all that. And that are just these, like the diagrams that we were using. Oops. And then there, at least for my branch, I put a test plan in here. This is not a great test plan, but I think it will get the gist of everything and has everything that you need to do it. Yeah, that's basically it. It's pretty much organized the exact same way you saw in the IDE because it is. And then
everything's pushed, right, Austin?
Almost, yes. See, 5 hours ago, I made sure that everything that I had done was pushed, and then I kept working on it because I can't help myself.
Okay, well, that's good.
So, and then Ashraf, if you want to go through your branch, the Marionette code, I will give you the screen.
Ashraf, are you muted?
Ashraf, you're muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, sweet. So now I was going to add the README file here. I didn't add it yet. So, but like basically all these been explained in the document that I did, the Marionette, this document over here. So like whenever a code or something we've been using or the way of using it is basically in this document, either Marionette or BigaBoom AI, anything over, it should be over here. To explain how the code's functioning. And yeah, all these codes been tested and been working. Those just examples whenever basically we're gonna be mainly focusing on, we're gonna have the ADC. So yeah, this is the only code now. I was working on it and I stopped basically just this one. It's incomplete because we had to connect this one to the actuary controller. So in here, this one, if someone gonna keep going, whenever we connect this to actuary controller, we're gonna figure out a way just to clean the data and how we communicate over here. So basically that's it for this code. Anything else has been working? Those ones, the one that I used it for when I was testing the pressure sensors or whatever you want to test the sensors and have it saved as a CVS. I called it saving ADC as CVS. So this is cool whenever we're going to test any more sensors in the future. Yep. That's it for my section. Do you want to? Yeah.
Good. All right. Is there anything else we should go over?
I don't think so. I think that was pretty much everything.
Did we touch on the long report document?
Oh yeah, pull that up.
Jake, are you pulling that or
do you want me to? If you can do it, that'd be great.
Okay.
And show where it is just so we see it.
Yeah. That was in the Google Drive. In that top level, it's one of those.
In the top level, okay, good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so can you see this browser? Okay. So that is in the presentation stuff, I believe. Wait, no. Sorry, it's right here, the final project report. And there is some scaffolding that needs to be torn out of this, but we have a table of contents that covers all the sections. I don't know how much detail you want to go into.
No, just scroll through it. You don't need to go in detail. So this is your final report.
Yes.
Okay, great.
This is mostly more 10,000 foot view than super gritty details.
Yeah.
Or project requirements. These are mostly unchanged except for hardware deliverables. Diagrams, explanation of the individual components.
Yeah.
A bunch of okay, comments good. To tear out. Yeah.
Good. That's all we need, just to know where we can find it so we can direct people to it. All
right. And then we have a test plan section. It's, you know. Okay.
Good. All right, you guys. Anybody, any questions from anyone else? No, all right. Well, I think that's it. Does anybody have anything else before I stop the recording? Nope, congratulations, you guys. You put together a TAR system despite COVID, which was weird and virtual. And congratulations, guys, you're done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, I'm gonna stop recording.